Many of us, because we have developed the habit of believing everything that we hear, implementing everything we hear, that is why we have developed a dead community. Today, the inventions, developments of the world, where do they go? They go from Islamic countries to the West. Every person who indulges with the Quran is in need of specific tools. Without those tools, we cannot understand the Quran. We cannot explore the Quran. What are those tools? Number one is the aql, the intellect. We cannot explore, we cannot understand, we cannot study the Quran without the aql. Many have tried and they have failed miserably in order to understand the Quran, but without aql, strictly relying on the second aspect, which is the naql, the narration. Inshallah, we'll get to that. How so? They say that Abu Hanifa, Al-Imam Abu Hanifa, he was teaching a class. And in his class, he says, I have a new theory. And my theory is, Allah cannot punish the shaitan. Because Allah created shaitan from what? From fire. And in the day of judgment, those who he wants to punish, where does he put them? Into fire. So fire cannot be punished with fire. This is my new theory. Buhlul was sitting there. So he says to him, are you sure you're not going to change your mind about this? He says, yeah, I'm sure. This is my new theory. So Al-Imam Abu Hanifa, he came out of the class and Buhlul was there, standing with a brick. As soon as he came out, he hit him with the brick and he broke his head and there was blood and they took him to the judge. So the judge said, Buhlul, did you hit him? He says, yeah. Why did you hit him? He says, because Abu Hanifa, according to him, everyone is forced to do that which they do. He does not believe in free will. He believes that everything that we do is predetermined for us. Allah dictates what we do. So I didn't really hit him. Allah hit him. Second, Abu Hanifa believes that Allah on the day of judgment cannot punish shaitan with fire because he's created from fire. Abu Hanifa, what are you created with? He says, clay. He says, I only hit you with clay. I didn't think it was going to hurt you. Similarly, if you go to tafsir, for example, Surah Al-Jinn, one of the grand mufassireen, when he comes to the relationship of human beings and the jinn, he says, and yes, indeed, there are relationships between human beings and jinn to an extent of marriage. For there are women who have married jinn. Not only that, but they also have become pregnant from the jinn. And we have children that are born from the jinn. I don't understand where this guy's aql, his intellect, went when he was writing those things. Another scholar comes and says that yes, indeed, science says pregnancy can take up to 9 months. But pregnancy in Islam can take up to 10 years. 10 years. Now don't ask me why they say such things. They all have a reason. For example, there was a woman whom her husband died, 10 years later she gave birth. So this alim, immediately he writes this. Another one, we don't know who got her pregnant, he says the jinn got her pregnant. Those are money. Therefore, the aql is the main element and main navigation system and drive when it comes to understanding the Qur'an. Without the aql, the Qur'an not also becomes meaningless, but it can also become dangerous. So number one is aql. When we come into the majalis, when we sit down, when we listen, who told you that everything you listen, you should program it in your brain? Who told you that? Any person who you meet, who speaks, is fallible or infallible? Fallible. I myself can make mistakes. Anyone else sitting here can make mistakes, unless you sit in the majlis of a ma'soom. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with the aql. Go and read. Research. Ask. Or from the west of the Islamic countries. Huh? From the west of Islamic countries. Why? Because in Islamic countries, most Islamic countries, everything that you are taught, everything that you hear, don't question. You have no right to question anything. Who told you to question? Who are you to speak? But here, you can speak whatever you like. Ask whatever you like. Say whatever you like. And that is why the mind has no limits, has no restrictions, and therefore, they reach what they reach today. Inventions. New technologies. So what happens? The Islamic world has to import them. From the TV to the microwave to the cars to the... And now, if we want to study, what do we say? What do we do? We export our children to those universities. Go there. There they let you ask. There they don't limit you. Ahlelbayt, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhim, brothers and sisters, don't look at Islam today. I urge you to read. I urge you to go and look at Kitab al-Kafi, Kitab al-Ihtijaj, Uyun Akhbar al-Ridha. There would be atheists that come and debate our imams. Atheists. Christians, Jews, Magans, pagans, idol worshippers. All the way until the time of Imam al-Sadiq, Imam al-Ridha, Imam Hassan al-Askari. Imam Hassan al-Askari developed a tafsir. Why? Because there were some people writing books within the Islamic Ummah, writing books on the false ayat of the Quran. False ayat within the Quran. He's a so-called Islamic scholar writing a book on the false ayat of the Quran. Today, if anybody in any Muslim country writes a book about false ayat from the Quran, what happens to him? Instead of other scholars writing, replying, responding, this is what our imams taught us. Our imams, they have set the highest standards, brothers and sisters. The highest standards of tolerance. The highest standards in akhlaq. The highest standards of human morality. But yet, unfortunately, we have created a gap between ourselves and their teachings. So number one is aql. The aql needs to be there. Number two is naql, al-manqul. The second tool is the Quran itself. To understand the Quran, you need the Quran. To understand the Quran, you need the Quran itself. You cannot come to one ayah, read that ayah and say, this is the Quranic perspective in regards to this issue. No. Sometimes you have to read 20 ayat, 10 ayat, 5 ayat in order to understand the Islamic perspective in regards to one issue. يا أيها الذين آمنوا لا تأكلوا أموالكم بينكم بالباطل إلا أن تكون تجارة عن تراض بينكم. O you believers, Do not take each other's wealth and goods unless both parties are pleased. Both parties are content. So today somebody comes to me and he says, give me a loan. I say, here is 100,000. Pay me back 120,000. He says, okay. I say, are you sure you're okay with it? He says, yeah, I'm sure. Okay, so I'm giving the loan, 100,000, receiving another loan, 120,000. The guy is okay with it. And Allah in the Quran says what? يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَأْكُلُوا أَمْوَالَكُمْ بَيْنَكُمْ بِالْبَاطِلِ إِلَّا أَن تَكُونَ تِجَارَةً عَنْ تَرَاضٍ بَيْنَكُمْ. Does that mean the Quran says it's okay? No. We go to another ayah. حَلَّ اللَّهُ الْبَيْعَ وَحَرَّمَ الرِّبَى. So in order to understand the Quran, we need the Quran itself. Number two, we need the hadith. Without hadith, no one can explore the Quran. One ignorant man in history, he said this. Hasbukum kitab Allah. The Quran is enough for you. But we ask him, tell me from the Quran, how many rak'ah salat al-dhuhr? How many rak'ah salat al-subuh? Tell me, Allah says pay zakat. How do I pay zakat on sheep in the Quran? How do I pay zakat on my cattle? Tell me, I have to do tawaf. How many rounds of tawaf do I have? Tell me from the Quran. If the Quran is enough. Therefore, we need hadith. And not only hadith, but we need to examine the hadith. Who's in the chain of narrators? Is this hadith sahih? Is this hadith hasan? Is this hadith a hadith that I can accept and incorporate within the science of rijal? So those are the tools that we need.